far away from you, but you know, we're the ones, we get a little table here.
That's a shame.
My name is Mel Leitner, class of 71, and this is and this is the panel, What We Talk When We Talk About Race, a New Journalism Paradigm. As a former wire service hack, I'll try to keep this tight and focused. Before I get into that, I'd like to offer special thanks to Maria Newman of the Alumni Office for taking a well-meaning idea and shepherding it to reality. It's true. Last fall, the Alumni Office organized a conference call of class enablers to come up with ideas for panels for this weekend. After listening quietly for about 30 minutes, I proposed this panel on reporting and race. For me, it was a no-brainer. I'm from the class of 71. At our commencement, I looked around and thought we were the funkiest, meanest, most badass, and most diverse of any of Columbia's professional schools graduating that day. Yes, we were entering a profession that was mostly white and mostly male. And yes, Richard Nixon had been named Time Magazine's 1971 Man of the Year. But we felt times were changing, and we're going to be part of that change. Yet now, I find myself talking with my daughters about the same issues, the same challenges that enraged us 45 years ago, and across College Walk, Lowe Library is still being occupied. Back then, my biggest technological challenge was finding a functioning payphone. Today, it's easier and more complicated. Much of our news and perceptions are shaped in the echo chamber of social media. Today, going to the videotape often means something caught by a passing cell phone. Think Eric Gardner, think Tamir Rice, think Ferguson, Cleveland, and Staten Island. Now, I have one daughter who's doing a doctorate in cultural anthropology in Oklahoma, another, a master's in education at Harvard. Both have been actively involved with and buffeted by all the debates, controversies, and protests sweeping campuses across this country. They send me learned articles, and we talk on the phone using all the buzzwords ricocheting around academia in our op-ed pages. Another motivator was my classmate Margot Jefferson's memoir, Negroland. Perhaps because I know her, the book resonated in unexpected ways. Those of you who've read it know exactly what I mean. Now, Maria Newman of the alumni office gently warned me not to turn this talk into a white man's guilt trip. She also reminded me that I'd be speaking to a sophisticated audience. Many of you report, write, and are deeply involved in these issues. This is not a subject in my wheelhouse. I'm a lot more comfortable discussing Richard Neustadt's bureaucratic political theory as it applies to Middle East policy than I am about race. But I gotta say, outside these ivy walls, millions of well-meaning citizens, the ones who voted for Barack Obama, have little real appreciation of what microaggression, systemic racism, or white privilege are all about. There's a library of academic research backing this up. Why is that? And what can we, as a profession, do about it? We're fortunate today to have a remarkable panel of journalists and thinkers who've been wrestling with these issues day in and day out. They also represent four different decades of J School graduates, which speaks to me to the enduring values of the Columbia Graduate School of Journalism. Our moderator is Suzanne Malveaux, class of 91. Suzanne is a national correspondent for CNN. She's been a White House reporter. She's covered Katrina for her hometown of New Orleans, and she's covered the Arab Spring. She's interviewed all five living presidents and many of first ladies. I've already mentioned Margot, and I'll let Suzanne tell you more about her and the other panelists. Hillard Pouncey, a former lecturer at Princeton and also from my class of 71. David Gonzalez, class of 83 of the New York Times. And Terrence McCoy, class of 12. I feel very old, of the Washington Post. Prepare to be wowed. Thank you. Suzanne?
Thank you, Bill, appreciate that. Thank you, everybody, it's a pleasure. It's gonna be a very interesting, provocative conversation. We'll start off, I'm gonna introduce, give you a little bit more about the background, but if you want more details, it's in the program, because we do have an extraordinary panel today. And we'll go ahead and start with some discussion points, and then we'll open up to Q&A for the audience, probably in the last 30 minutes or so, kind of depending on where we want to go with this. But very briefly, because I know you know them, they're extraordinary. Margot Jefferson, right beside me, class of 71, Pulitzer Prize winning culture critic, writer for the New York Times, as well as Newsweek, and recently published her award-winning autobiography called Negroland, A Memoir. So thank you very much, Margot, for joining us. I appreciate that. David Gonzalez, class of 83, as you know, co-editor of the New York Times Lens blog, writes the paper's Side Street column. Among the many topics that he covers is really the change and how Latino immigration is remaking the United States. David? Hillard Pouncey, class of 71, lecturer at Princeton University's Woodrow Wilson School of Public and International Affairs, author of Ending Poverty in America, How to Restore the American Dream, and Black Males Left Behind. And Terry McCoy, class of 2012, staff writer at the Washington Post, covering poverty as well as social justice, recently won an award for a series regarding the hundreds of lead poisoning victims in Baltimore, including the late Freddie Gray, and he'll talk a little bit more about that specifically. So again, let's give everybody a round of applause for being here. So our question today is, what do we talk about when we talk about race and whether or not there is a new journalism paradigm? And I'm gonna ask each one of them to give a story and an illustration of how that might be true in their own work. I'm gonna start off with a story of my own, having covered politics and covering the campaign of 2016, perhaps how race is discussed and how it's treated and what it reveals in 2016. I'll take you back to October of last year. It was Clark Atlanta University in Atlanta, historically black college. That's where Hillary Clinton was just starting to make her way through the southern contests and states and really wanted to get the black support, the black community support, and was rolling out this effort and was at this university. The people who were introducing her really was kind of a who's who in the civil rights movement. So you had Congressman John Lewis who was there and who had just recently been recognized by the students at that college for his role in Selma. The movie had come out and they were giving him an award, and he actually talked about in very vivid terms about being beaten and being on the bridge at that time, the hoses, and just what he endured to march forward in the civil rights movement. On that stage with Congressman Lewis, you also had the former mayor of Atlanta, Andy Young. You also had Shirley Franklin, and you had the current mayor of Atlanta, Kasim Reed, all of them there to roll out this introduction of Hillary Clinton. When this happened, and they did announce her, she came out and she was at the podium, started to speak, and as you probably were aware, quickly afterwards, a group, very, very small group actually, of protesters of Black Lives Matter, filed into the auditorium, started shouting, Black Lives Matter, Black Lives Matter. Another group in the audience was shouting, let her speak, let her speak, you know, go Hillary. This lasted extraordinarily for about 30 minutes as she continued on with her speech, kind of talking, at first trying to address the group by saying, yes, Black Lives Matter, let me tell you why or let me tell you how. But that didn't work. So engagement didn't work. Then it was kind of like, well, let me try to kind of drown it out or ignore it. So she spoke for 30 minutes as they were still chanting. It was a very tense 30 minutes in the room, as you can imagine, as people were frustrated. You could see the faces of Congressman Lewis and all of the other civil rights dignitaries who wanted this to stop, to end in some way. But they did not confront these protesters. It wasn't about 30 minutes until they did go into the audience and try to convince them, these black leaders, to ask them to leave or to be quiet. After they couldn't, they went up physically on stage and joined Hillary Clinton, literally the congressman and the current mayor, to which she said, I'm so glad to see that the congressman and the mayor have my back. Literally and figuratively, they had her back. At that point, it really was a signal for security to come and take them away because they could not physically convince these students to go on their own accord, no matter how much they appealed to those students as part of leaders of the black community. So they left. And afterwards, we talked to Black Lives Matter and asked them why did they do this. And they told me that her social justice agenda was too little, too late. We talked to Congressman Lewis, who said, this is a different generation, this is a different group. It was unfortunate that they did not listen to the secretary, former Secretary of State. And to the supporters, they were even more convinced and loved her even more because she had a resilience that she was able to carry on for 30 minutes as this continued. What did we take away from this? What was that moment about? Well, clearly in October, what it said to many of us is that Hillary Clinton's appeal and her effort to win the black vote is gonna be, it's a lot more complicated and it's gonna be a lot harder than she imagined, that there's clearly a generational divide. And then secondly, what do we do with this movement? It cannot be ignored. It cannot be shooed away, but this movement, the Black Lives Matter movement, would become a part of the political discussion and part of something that would add the concerns of many people in that particular community. Fast forward, we saw it just last week with President Bill Clinton and his confrontation with Black Lives Matter protesters about his crime bill, as well as about Hillary Clinton's use of the word long ago, super predator. And what's that?
Yes.
And to put a button on this, to put a button on it, to put a bow on this, what he said and was very telling, because there was pushback from the Hillary Clinton campaign. They did not think his anger and his, you know, talk back and his confrontation with this group was particularly helpful to her, because she had repudiated the word super predator, as well as tried to distance herself from the crime bill. So both of those, he was defending his wife and his policy and legacy, but not necessarily helpful to the Clinton campaign. But the next day he said that he almost felt like apologizing, but he really felt like he needed to engage this group and he needed to set the record straight. He needed to talk about race, he needed to talk about the crime bill, he needed to talk and engage, because that's not what people were doing. And that was also a moment where we learned a lot about perhaps there is a point here, a boiling point, where people have not been discussing this in a real way, and that was the way in which he was going to get that dialogue going. So with that, I would like to go ahead and ask each one of you to think about that question. What do you talk about when you talk about race? Is there a new journalism paradigm? Is there an example or a story that you can think of that might illustrate that? And Terry, I'll start with you, because Margo wants me to start that end.
Well, I think that's completely right. When I cover poverty and social justice for the Washington Post, and race represents the sort of tacit underpinnings of every story that I do, and I cover and I report mostly on what's happening in Washington D.C. and the region. I write a lot about what's going on in Baltimore as well. Last year, I did a series of stories about lead paint poisoning in Baltimore, and using what happened with Freddie Gray as kind of the way into that story. Because lead paint is a huge part of the history of the Northeast, and the effects of that poisoning have been predominantly felt in poor African-American communities. And Freddie Gray was archetypal of that. He showed a lot of what that meant to these communities and why it had such impact and how it continues to have impact in those communities. And I would interview lawyers who have represented thousands of victims of lead paint poisoning in Baltimore. And I would ask, what percentage of your clients were black? And they'd say, all of them. And I'd ask, how many have you represented? They'd say 4,000. So this is something that has been a scourge, that has been almost predominantly felt in one community. And so when I talk about race, these are the stories and these are the issues that I report on. And race represents something that is felt throughout the entire piece, just because that's just what it is. I'm doing another story right now about how the district government wants to put a homeless shelter for kids next to the biggest bus garage in the city, where they service hundreds of buses and emits lots of exhaust fumes. But the thing is that asthma is felt so much more in poor black communities than other communities. Washington, D.C. is a city that wheezes. And this is a place where it's a real issue in these families, and putting a bunch of homeless kids next to a giant bus garage who probably have asthma, I mean, these are issues that aren't just race, but really when I write about this stuff, it is race, because it's affecting just one community. And that's really what a lot of my job is.
All right, Terry, thank you. Hillard.
Well, I'm going to make up a story, because I don't really have one. And the story I'm going to make up is...
The New Journalism.
Yes, A Return to Forever. The story I'm going to make up is sometimes a newspaper... will bring a person like me in to talk to the staff, and it's considered a day off from the norm. You know, we're not going to have to worry for a half hour because, you know, an academic is going to say something academic, and it'll be a relaxing time for us. And so I'm that guy. This is what I do. And if I were to be brought in, which is more or less what's happening now, to say, what is the is there a new paradigm for talking about race in journalism and beyond? This is what I would say. And I would put it like this. I'd say, look, Terry's got it right. The real interesting question would be, could you write a story that if you didn't use, and you use your imagination, could you not make it relevant to race in some way? And I would put a bet out, and I would give money to the journalist, a working journalist, who could write a story and not show me why and how it's not related to race. So I think he's got it right. And then what I'd also say is, so let's step behind the story of the day to the larger issue, the larger trend. How should our stories work? Or I guess the panel would say, what's this new paradigm? And I don't know about you, but what I liked about journalism is we were always trying to figure out what's normal. Because if it's normal, it's not news, right? So our whole job is to figure out what's not normal. And for race, that's very, very tricky, right? Is it normal for youngsters to get beaten up by the police? Well, at a period in our history, that wouldn't have been a story. Now it is. So the behind the story's issue, the paradigm is, so what is normal? How should we, since we know we're going to encounter race no matter what our beat is, how do we know what's a race story because it's not normal? And I would give them this homework assignment, because that's what I do. I would say, is the real story about race in America a story about the end of difference, meaning that although it may seem like a long shot, are we essentially walking through the debris of our history so that the story is, why is that a difference and shouldn't it not be different? Why are we treating minority youth or, pick a category, frankly, why are we treating people differently? Isn't it about time we lived up to the promise of the democracy? And then I'd say, but that's possible. But I actually think there might be something else going on. And I call this one the canary in the coal mine effect, meaning that the relevance of race is that what happens to this country's poor, its minorities, its powerless, are becoming increasingly a signal for what's happening to all of us. Now, I could elaborate on that, but I think, frankly, I'm with a group that's kind of with me on this and would understand it. And I can just give a quick example. In a paper I'm finishing now, we're talking about family formation and differences by race and family formation. And the story there is, as a society, about half our youngsters today are born in non-marital households, which it would be not news, right? That's by definition normal. But the issue, the thing is, that the very thing that within the lifetimes of some of us was a big story, the Danny Patrick Moynihan story, that African Americans, and let's freak out about it, are having homes without fathers. That was a 20% of African American households were being born in households that were defined as non-marital households. Well, white America, that number is about 25 to 30%. And for African Americans, it's way north of 50%. So the issue is, what happens to one group in our society is our destiny. So that's why race is a big story. And then I'd let them go out and figure it out.
I'm going to talk about the changes that I've seen from my perspective editing the Lens blog at the Times. When I started out in journalism in the 80s at Newsweek, and I did some foreign assignments working with photographers, the way you worked was the photographer took the pictures, put them in a sack, went to the airport either through freight, shipped it back to New York, or in breaking stories sometimes, look for somebody who had an honest face when you get on a plane, give them your film, and say there'll be somebody waiting for you at the other side. That's how it was back then. Let's choose a country, Haiti. Folks go, cover the elections, or the lack of, photograph it, photograph people in some community. Those people will never see that photographer again, most likely will never see that picture ever again. And people build reputations, some good, some not, whatever. Let's fast forward now. Several years ago, we got a submission at the blog of a Russian photographer who had been going to Haiti over the past year, several trips, photographing Rustavex. These are children usually from the countryside who have been brought in essentially as indentured servants for families in the city. And he did a very gripping series of photographs. We were blown away by it. Showed them to one of our writers who has long experience in Haiti. She was blown away by it. We wrote a piece on these images and this issue. Our posts go up at 5 in the morning. By around 9 o'clock on our Facebook page for Lens, we had a comment from a photographer in Missouri saying, there's an issue with these photographs in Haiti. It's like 4 hours after they go up. I call him. He tells me, you need to talk to one of the people in the pictures. Because the person who was being depicted as an adult who had this child in bondage in his home was actually the fixer and driver and interpreter for the photographer. You know, kind of like a no-no. So I said, can I get his email? Got his email. Shot an email to the guy. Give me your cell phone number. By noon, I am talking to this fixer by cell phone in Port-au-Prince. He then tells me, oh yeah, he knew that I was his driver. He told me not to talk to anybody about that though. I said, do you have the emails on that? He goes, oh sure. I said, could you send me the emails? So now I get all these emails from this photographer, not only discussing the fact that he's paying him, but wanting to set up future trips to go back and photograph his family again as an example of a family using one of these kids. So by now, 7 hours later, I have the story from this guy. So we wait until this guy wakes up in St. Petersburg, we call up the photographer, and we confront him with it. And he admits, and he said, well, I didn't think I was doing anything wrong. Well, you are. But this is the point of the story. Is in the old days, you would never would have heard from this driver. These pictures would have gotten out there, the world would have seen them. They were very gripping images. They were compassionate, if you will. And people would have said, this is an amazing piece of journalism. But nowadays, we want to talk about new paradigms. The people you photograph, the people you interview, even in the developing world, maybe especially in the developing world, where everybody has a cell phone because there aren't any landlines, will be able to see your work. They will be able to react, and they will be able to tell you if you got it wrong. And how, if you look at social media, they will come back at you. And I think it's a good thing, but it challenges old ways of how we do things. No longer can you just parachute into a place, photograph it, and walk away thinking nobody will ever see it or react. And I think that's, you know, one of the big game changers that I've seen, especially when we're talking about communities of color, you know, countries in the developing world, where the narrative has often taken a certain tone. I think now more people who are invested in those stories, or are living those stories, or the subjects of the stories, can see that and can let you know. And I think that's one of the big game changers that I've seen, especially in the world of photography.
Thank you, David.
Well, I'm an arts and culture person, so take a deep breath, and I'm gonna talk a little bit about Beyoncé. Perhaps a secret obsession of other people here. But definitely a cultural obsession. Okay, in last August, Vogue magazine, where I have years before been a contributing editor, contacted me and asked if I would write a think piece on Beyoncé for their fall September issue, which was called Forces of Fashion, and which was going to feature women who were considered exactly that. I didn't realize at the time that it was partly a think piece, because with the culture critic's vanity, I thought, well, of course they want a think piece from me. I did not realize then, which was my lack, I didn't do my research, that Beyoncé was not giving interviews to anybody. She had put a ban on that. This has recently been lifted. I would have done the piece anyway. Okay, I start to write it, and immediately I get somewhat into a bit of a push-pull. I had an editor I liked, but it's a fashion magazine, you know, and there had to be a lot of room for adjective-laden quotes from designers about Beyoncé. And I got more and more interested as I entered this world of, you know, websites and whatever, in the obsession with her racial, quote, origins and identity. There were whole websites devoted to this. The hits, you know, huge. The only person who exceeded in terms of questions about, you know, the parsing, the, you know, which parent is what? Well, you know, her father is browner, her mother is paler. Is that, what's the Indian, African American, white mix? The only person who got more hits was Mariah Carey. This made its way very briefly into the piece, but it did get reduced. And what I found so interesting was that, among other things, she's an interesting figure, was that Beyoncé had so staggeringly, effectively, and efficiently kind of navigated these spaces where every constituency could deal as much or as little, could fantasize as much or as little, could be excited by, could be a little threatened by as much or as little as they wanted to, because she was dispersed through so many media outlets. And that that to me was very interesting, because culture is still fraught, as we know. Look at the recent Oscars controversy with, you know, real kind of traditional issues of race, power, and status, and exclusion, etc. Well, I recently, as some of you may have seen, can I see a show of hands how many of you may have seen some version of Beyoncé's, you know, now called Race Proud, Black Proud video formation? Okay. All right. I recently got asked by The Guardian to do a short piece on what this said, or did it say, was the question, much about, you know, her evolving, her statements about racial identity. And my first thought, so this is a, in terms of paradigm, this is generational as well, was, okay, I enjoyed that video, you know, it's full of charm and moxie and a certain kind of imagistic daring. But please, you know, I mean, in my generation, the Black Panthers were really out in the street, you know, it's a video, okay? But again, I started, you know, critics, again, tend to be a little arrogant, and yes, we've always read clips, but our research often took us, as we saw it, into very intellectual realms. What this story taught me was that, you know, the on-the-ground material is you experienced it with this photography story, the on-the-ground material which deeply affects and inflects your authority as a critic, you know, is this these vast communities of responders. You know, a website called, you know, I think Black Southern Girls, they were beside themselves with what this meant in terms of, you know, I love my husband, Michael Jackson knows, you know. So this conversation that I've heard a thousand times about this light-skinned woman with straightened hair marrying this dark-skinned man with broad features, suddenly, you know, it was foregrounded. It was there. And I realized that this whole world around Beyoncé, but also around what we think of as cultural entertainment, is absolutely fraught with and split open with these kinds of, you know, very intense, vehement, not always rational responses that so shape, you know, the so-called, that so shape our culture, the cultures of race, of response, of even ultimately policy. So I decided, you know, okay, I probably do need to do this piece because I can't trust my first reaction, which was, oh, come on, you know, something for everybody, Black Panther berets, you know, she's adorable, give me a break. You know, it matters more than that because all of this is in our conscious and unconscious lives, and culture, popular culture, is one of the only zones in which we actually do talk about these things in a fairly uncensored way. So how does one, you know, find the way to, as a critic, join the conversation rather than, yes, we still use our intelligence and our what we think of as our expertise, but rather than to always be officiating at it. That, I would say, would be the new, an interesting paradigm for cultural and arts critics writing and thinking about race, which, as Hillard said, you know, comes up in a thousand ways. Also, when we talk about race, we're talking these days about races, not only race, not only two in contention.
And Margot, I want to follow up with that, because in your memoir, you talk about Lena Horne and you talk about Dorothy Dandridge. And I wonder, are we seeing, when you talk about this obsession with Beyonce, has it changed that much? Are we expressing ourselves in some of the things that we felt generations back, just in a different form, in a different way? That she's the different embodiment, the Beyonce
she's
was the Lena
Horne. She's an embodiment of a certain kind of universally admired and accepted black beauty. You know, you do have alternatives to that. You have Lupita Nyong'o. But you also have that controversy about the Nina Simone movie where, you know, the studio found Zoe Saldana, and then, you know, these pictures emerged of her in deep brown face makeup with a fake nose. Along with many, many articles pointing to other black actresses who certainly could have played the role. So are we dealing with the same old tropes and types of what's acceptable in terms of glamour, desirability? Sure. Sure we are.
And David...
But that doesn't mean one puts her down. A lot of the criticism I also found during this piece was, well, you know, she's lightened her hair, has she had a nose job? You know,
The same.
Let it go. The policing also from within the community.
David, you wrote a very interesting article, and this was about the Oscars so white, and that really there was a certain frustration, I think, that you had because it really didn't touch upon the Latino community and what that meant in terms of many of the actors and directors mm-hmm. who are very much, you know, neglected in that form. Can you talk a little bit about when we discuss race, if that's something that is familiar to you, that is reoccurring?
I mean, it kind of is. I mean, if you look at Latinos in this country, we're kind of like the universal donor on race. we come in all colors. We have, you know, blonde hair, blue eyes to folks who are indigenous, to folks, if you go to Cuba, you see the connection to Africa very, very clearly. So we run the spectrum. But all too often, and this is starting to change, but all too often it's been always, you know, a black-white discussion. And Latinos kind of complicated. There's much more nuance. There are much more points of friction. There are also more points of view. And there are also a lot of commonality, too. I mean, as a Puerto Rican growing up in New York in the 60s and 70s, we were very, very close with African Americans. We lived in the same neighborhoods, went to the same schools, went to each other's homes, listened to a lot of the same music. So there was that interaction then. And so when this started happening with Oscars So White, I was aware of a group of Latinos who were doing what started as a web series, but now they're actually going to try to pitch it as a pilot, a 22-minute pilot, you know, either Netflix, Amazon, whoever. And it's involving a lot of people who have real experience. I mean, Sonia Gonzalez-Martinez started out working for Spike Lee, worked for Milos Forman, does documentaries. Mm-hmm. Angela Lozada, who's the male lead, is the warm-up comic for Trevor Noah, The Daily Show. These are folks that are, you know, have real jobs, and they're committed to this. And so they felt, I had seen her post on social media this thing about how we are trying to do this. It's not just a black-white thing. So I did a column on them, and the quote that set off some readers from her is like, we know Oscars are so white. There's nothing new about that. And, you know, putting out that hashtag isn't going to change an institution. What's going to change an institution is making content, producing shows, giving them something that's so good they can't turn away from. And that got a lot of pushback from people because they felt that she was, you know, dissing Black Lives Matter, Oscars. I mean, she was just saying, no, what she wanted to do was, rather than do that, because she had her activist phase in the 90s, was actually just produce a show that looked at 40-something Latinos in the Bronx dealing with life as 40-something Latinos raising a kid and being professionals. And that was what they were trying to get out there, just show that, you know, it's not just that. Now, what's interesting is I saw after that column came out, there was, and this wasn't related to the column, but a friend of mine was talking to me about how there was some pushback from some of the folks from Oscar So White, where they created a new hashtag called Not Your Mule, saying that since Latinos and others who are complaining about Oscar So White now, where were they when the struggle was going on? And so you had that kind of almost like infighting on social media about, did these other groups that are now saying they want a seat at the table, had they quote unquote paid their dues? And I think, you know, if you take a historical look, yes, they have actually. I mean, you know, Black and Latino communities have worked together on a number of issues over the years, especially also in the fields of culture and music. So there's that tension out there, though, still. And I think when it comes to people looking at those communities, writing about them, I think you got to realize that when you're dealing with these issues about race, it's a lot more complicated. In cities like New York, for example, where you really do have this great gamut of people from, you know, Garifuna Hondurans, you know, to Argentines in Queens, to, you know, Mixtecas in Sunset Park in Brooklyn. I mean, it's really complicated. And, you know, the onus is on us as journalists to begin to understand just how complicated it can be.
In light of the complexity, though, I mean, do you think that now, 2016, we are seeing kind of a broad brush stroke, a dumbing down, if you will, of the understanding of all the different types of groups in the Latino community when you have people, you know, in the campaign, Donald Trump, who's painting that broad brush stroke of talking about immigration in a way that many Americans are starting to just simply talk about immigration as illegal immigration, and everybody seems to be lumped in together, or you have everybody, you know, all of the Muslims who are not being allowed to enter the United States, the broad brush stroke of saying that they are potential terrorists. I mean, does that frustrate you? Where are we in that understanding of that community?
I mean, it's a process. I think we're getting further along now than we were when I went to school here, for example. And I think you see things, I mean, you really got to start looking at the communities themselves and seeing what's going out there. I mean, one of the big things happening in some Latino communities is this whole push for the recognition of Afro-Latinos. You know, that sometimes when we talk about Latinos, we just talk about lighter skin or brown Latinos, when you have Black Latinos. And that's, you know, for example, that's one of the big things that I see out there, whether it's in the level of music or in the level of politics. And looking for ways to show that this is more complicated. I think journalism in general sometimes looks to simplify things, to explain things to people. I mean, if you only have 800 words, you know, how deep can you get into it?
Suzanne, can we jump in?
Please, go ahead.
No, because this is really great. This is, and so here's what we think. So so Margot talks about this discovery of almost a river of discourse that you can now see because of the new media, and that's such a rich topic, right? What is there something that we didn't know about in our society? Because some of us thought, you know, we were making social change in one direction, and this new media suggests, boy, were we wrong. And so, is there something we've been missing, and as journalists, you know, what do we do about it? And or has social media, is that just one element of it? And social media has been actually useful for building communities, bridging communities, or I guess the sharpest way to put it, is there something about this our new forms of discourse and the new provision of discourse, the media, and this current election? I know you wanted us to focus on the immigration question, but no. With Donald Trump and this current election, it's just too good to just limit it to discourse, I mean, to immigration. So we don't have an answer, but that, I certainly as one member of the panel, but that was a really rich question, the connection between not just journalism, but new arenas of journalism. And some outcomes. I mean, you cover this election, and are we seeing a difference in the way we elect a president? In part because we have access to new conversations.
Terry, go ahead.
This is connected to you, Terry. It also occurs to me, you know,
What's the connection? You're talking about lead paint poisoning. Right now, students have occupied Low Library, environmental activists, you know, fossil fuel, divest, you know. So how do those, these are, 40 years ago, people thought of, you know, civil rights and environmentalism as, pal, you know, but as really not having much to do with each other.
Yeah, I think that's interesting. I also want about the social media aspect of the conversation about race. I think social media has can both offer a unfiltered, unvarnished glimpse into what's really going on, what's happening out there, and also can distort or exaggerate what's happening. Twitter. Journalists are, you know, we love doing stories about Twitter because, you know, we don't even have to leave our desk. We can just look on the computer and people are saying this or this on Twitter. And boom, their story's done. But a lot of times I think that can distort actually the reality of what's happening because a very certain sort of demographic is on Twitter, a very liberal demographic is on Twitter, an educated demographic is on Twitter. And a lot of people who I write about when I'm in very poor communities in Baltimore or DC, none of them are on Twitter. They're not tweeting their thoughts. They're not seeing what's going on out there on Twitter. And so we are missing a lot of times what is actually happening because we have become so dependent on reporting on social media. Social media does two things. It can both give us a true picture of what's happening and also distort it. And I think that's something that as journalists we need to think about a lot because it's so easy to report on social media. It's so easy to report on race on social media. And I think we get a lot of stories wrong because of it. And I think that does come back to the election right now.
Can you give us an example?
Of the election right now?
How we get it wrong, like through social media. Do you have something you can throw out there?
So the Post, we did this big story last year about police shootings. And for the first time, the Post, it was this incredible investigation going back and tracking every single day someone who got shot by police. We had these researchers waking up every morning and combing through all of these records and newspaper clips to find out who got shot, what their color was, the circumstances of it. And so police shootings and police brutality is a huge issue right now with race, huge issue with Black Lives Matter. It's the issue right now of the moment. And so much of the attention, and rightfully so, has gone to situations in which unarmed Black men are being shot by police. And this is an incredibly important issue, and we have not talked about it enough. But what the Post found at the same time was that there were about 1,000 police shootings, and the number of shootings that turned out to be contested or that were very suspicious and charges were brought and punishment was meted out was about 4% of those shootings. And so the idea was that through social media, through all this conversation, I think to one extent, the picture of this police brutality was a little bit exaggerated, and people thought that it was one thing. But when we looked at the facts, it turned out that there was another situation that in no way took away from the horrors and from the tragedies that were inflicted upon these people. There have not been enough stories about that. But at the same time, to a certain extent, social media can exaggerate or also just augment something to such a degree that it subsumes the whole conversation.
Does anyone want to jump in? There is another point. There is another aspect to that, which, interestingly enough, today there was breaking news that some of the Nigerian girls who had been captured by Boko Haram there had been a video released, and you saw that some of them were alive, and, you know, where are they? They don't know, but that was something that was happening. And the reason why, you know, the world started to pay attention to this mass abduction was really what, you know, people were calling Black Twitter, and that is that the Black intelligentsia and newsmakers and trendsetters who are online, who are part of a community, brought to our attention, bring our girls back, the hashtag, which Michelle Obama went and everybody else, but largely came from that community, which has been, you know, called Black Twitter. And it's one of the ways that you have, you know, 140 characters that can kind of put a real focal point on something that is extremely important. and in the role of social media. So I throw that out there as kind of a counterexample of how that's being used. Do you want to jump in?
Well, I kind of want to throw it open again. If one of the problems of journalism has always been, you know, the headline and the simplification, then social media, for all its virtues, absolutely contributes to that.
No, it does. Yeah. I mean, looking at the question of Boko Haram, the girls that were abducted, there was a campaign a couple of months afterwards that was putting out photographs saying, you know, bring them back. And it was photographs of young girls. And people assumed these were Nigerian girls. And actually, it turned out to be photographs by this photographer who had photographed girls in East Africa, nowhere near Nigeria. And so they were using these pictures. They were very good pictures, but they were using pictures, you know, as part of this campaign on the Nigerian girls, but using girls from not even Nigeria, not even that side of Africa. And that's the kind of stuff that can happen. I mean, and people on both sides of that issue saying, well, we're talking about generic girls, and it's like, that didn't fly with us. But with the photographer who was speaking with us was just outraged that they could just take her pictures and put them out there to stand in for a generic Nigerian girl. Mm-hmm. So,
who,
you know, you have to be careful
who
what's out
that?
There.
I don't know who did.
Excuse me?
Do you know who did that? Who
I
did
have
that?
To look back. I mean, the story came out about a year ago. Okay. We ran it on the blog, actually.
Mm-hmm. Taylor, it looked like you
I was going to follow up with this way. So the question was, distortion versus simplification and other effects.
Or simultaneously and rather than versus.
Right, yeah, right. How do you untangle the effects of a new arena of discourse? And I think, Terry, I'll start with you. You also did a story on the gentry of Georgetown and their use of social media. It was great. Do that one. And then I want to comment on it.
You should share.
Okay, so.
You should share that one.
Yeah, this is a story about Georgetown. I'm not sure if everyone's been there, but we're all familiar with the idea of Georgetown. It's one of the poshest shopping strips in the country. And it's also a community of people who have shops or they work in shops and they're worried about shoplifting because it's also a target for shoplifters because there's a lot of, you know, expensive stuff there. And so what they did was they created this sort of social media network called GroupMe in which everybody could get together and sort of under a clandestine veil communicate about who they thought were suspicious and say, there's a suspicious man who just came into my shop, you should watch out for him. And then they'll describe him. And then, so I did the story, I was able to get into this sort of, this community and mind sort of what they were talking about. And what came out was the fact that 95% of these people who they were talking about were black. Who they thought were suspicious. And they almost codified the language that they would discuss these people's suspicion. They would say, two AAs just walked into the store, standing for two African Americans. Or they would kind of just sometimes use things that touched on racial stereotypes. You know, so-and-so was reeking of weed or, quote, ratchet. And what that was, this sort of using this new media, we were able to get, in which people were communicating with each other, in which they thought no one else was looking or seeing, you're able to get this unvarnished glimpse into how people were really thinking about it. It's almost this anthropological experiment as far as like what people really thought about shoppers when they're coming in. And just framing that in the context of what Georgetown is, which is one of the wealthiest, whitest communities in the city of DC as well as in the country, and also who they were suspicious about, I thought said something very profound about race in America.
Yeah, and I love that story, but it also touches what you were pointing out, Margot, that if you, in an unexpected way, tap into these rivers of discourse, what do you make of that? So what I did, and I should use we because it's a collective effort, so we've been in Bedford-Stuyvesant, and we've been interested in what would happen if you just gave away smartphones. Just, you know, we can't emulate Georgetown because we don't have the smartphones. So what happens if we created the smartphone possibility and then asked people, how do you want to use them? And then when they were kind of worried about doing games, they said, but suppose we used them to solve a problem. Let's make getting a job a collective goal. But you know, you can easily imagine the ability to talk through these new arenas of discourse about social problems and mobilizing and targeting. In the case we're looking at, we're talking about just practical things like getting a job, but it's the same thing, right? The effect of a device and its way of letting us talk to each other in a community, and the same, you know, technology, you can get 180 degrees of difference in the story. I think, Margo, you were right that it's there's simultaneity to it, there's complexity to it. Oh yeah, it's a story.
I got to jump in here quickly. I actually misspoke a moment ago, and I think we're on the record, so I just want to make sure I get this right. It was 70% of people that they talked about on the application they thought suspicious was black, not 95%. Okay.
And also, I didn't write those books. I just edited. It was part of a collection. I was a contributor to edited volumes. Just
so. Any other corrections?
If I could just jump in, I mean, on one aspect of this that hasn't, we've kind of hinted at it. I mean, there are some real advantages to, you know, these new arenas too, though, and we've seen them, you know, on the Lens blog, in certain ways. If you follow Instagram, and in social media, it's becoming more and more increasingly visual, also. But you know, look at Instagram, look at the various everyday movements: Everyday Bronx, Everyday Africa, Everyday Incarceration. There are all these different groups out there that are putting out pictures about the realities of their community. In some cases, you're also seeing young photographers who don't really have access to the media, but have access to social media, who are doing really good work in these places and are kind of like changing the narrative. And you know, we follow this stuff. And in the past couple of years, we found, you know, a couple of really amazing photographers who are just putting up pictures on Instagram, not really quite knowing how to connect, but somehow they connected with us. Clay Benskin, African-American guy, works in Tribeca. He's a building manager in Tribeca. He is a born street photographer. There ever was. The guy has a gift. You look at the way he looks at the world, and it just, you're struck by it. And he's working it. It's not something random. He's obviously thinking about what he's doing, and he's putting it out there. And so we're able to like pick him and say, okay, let's feature this work. And all of a sudden now, he's among other photographers presenting his view. Getting more to the point of looking at how you portray your own community, there was a Filipina photographer that we found out about, Ziza Cruz Bacani. I heard about her through Rick Rocamora, who's a photojournalist, Filipino photojournalist in San Francisco. He sent me an email saying, there's this kid I found on Facebook last year, and I've been working with her, mentoring her via social media. She is a nanny in Hong Kong. He showed me her pictures. We were blown away. We had not seen somebody that young who had that level of style already. She had it. And she was photographing her life in Hong Kong. We published it. Other people started looking at it. She became a Magnum Foundation fellow last summer, where she was going around the world now photographing human trafficking, because some of the nannies and servants she knew in Hong Kong were there against her will. She wasn't. She had an employer actually who encouraged her to do photography. But sometimes, you know, we only would have found out about this stuff because of Instagram. So it offers new platforms for people to get recognized, and more importantly, to start changing the narrative and look at how your community is portrayed. And that, you know, I think that's really one of the most exciting things out there, the possibility of discovering new voices and new photographers, new writers who are out there doing this kind of stuff and challenging the perceived portrayal, the usual portrayal of these communities or these individuals.
I have one question, then we can open it up to the audience, because I think we'll have some time for that. But to all of you, the fact that people generally go to outlets where they are reinforced, where it is very much kind of this, you know, tribalism, if you will, going to their perspective corners. How much of this is really shedding, you know, the explosion of social media shedding, not the heat, but the light? Are we any more informed? Are we crossing our paths and learning more about each other, especially when you look at some of the, you know, the things that are happening in the 2016 election, where it does not seem like there's a sense of understanding that is happening? Yes, anyone?
Well, Suzanne, that's a great question, because it's the question I would have asked at this point anyway. So that's why it's a great question. And let's make sure we're clear about what we're saying. So the question really would be, what are the manifestations of some of the themes that we've been pulling out today? And for example, if you looked tonight at the coverage of the current campaign, would you see some of what we're talking about? And to me, the answer is yeah. The capacity for inclusion and increasing the arena for discourse, the undiscovered raw talent, what a great story. That's an element of it, but also the capacity for us to start becoming more tightly bound to some core identity and then become antagonistic to the other. That's also the possibility. You know, so we're trying to paint a picture with some complexity, some possibility that under certain conditions the levers get pushed one way and you get, you know, acrimony, and they get pushed another way and you get inclusion and all that. I think with this political campaign, it's obviously tilted towards separation, antagonism, fear, it's too late and it's too big a question to ask of what have we done as members of the press to either bring this about, or are we simply, as Margaret would have said, officiating and just looking and reflecting on what we're seeing? But yeah, I think this current campaign is paradigmatic of what we've been talking about here. If we had enough time, I would have floated the idea that, frankly, this election looks like what this country used to be like, and whether we'll ever go back to this, what Sarah Palin would call a mainstream, lamestream, is the question. But yeah, this idea that at least in our political discourse, get your rain gear out because we're looking for greater antagonism. Yeah, that would be one way of saying what have we wrought with all of this stuff we've been talking about, and how race is in there. But that's just my thought.
Terry, did you want
to? Yeah, I agree that we're kind of the way that the media is now is going back to how it was several generations ago, in which the media that you follow reinforces your own worldview. And I think that's more or less a manifestation of what's happening at the country at large. If you look at what's going on in poor white communities across the country, the rates of death, the death rates are going up dramatically. Women who are in their late 40s, at the turn of the century, around the year 2000, about 220 women out of 100,000 women in their late 40s died. And now it's at about 300. And this is just 15 years later. And so these death rates that we're seeing, they're going up in rural communities. I mean, this is stuff that you really only see in countries that are going through grand upheavals. Like at the fall of the Soviet Union, you saw death rates going up. This is stuff you normally don't see in developed countries. So I think a lot of that, and there's a direct correlation between white communities that have high death rates and the support for Donald Trump. The anger that they kind of feel that this country is not working for them is coming directly because it's not working for them. When death rates are going up the way that they are, and the fact that there's so much alcoholism, and if you are a 40-year-old woman in a lot of poor white communities, you're substantially more likely to smoke and drink heavily than your grandmother was. And these are real issues that do factor into the race that we're seeing in the election today.
Does anybody want to open up for questions? We do have microphones, or if you want to just stand, that's fine too. There's a microphone right here.
If everyone could stand up in line, if you guys have questions, that'd be great.
Thank you, panel. I'm also class of 71, Louise Levathes. In terms of changing the dialogue, what I am kind of astonished about as a science reporter is that none of the population genetics in the last 30 years, the work of Luca Cavalli-Sforza at Stanford, for example, has shown us that genetically, it's really impossible to talk about race. That in 6,000 or 8,000 years, you take an African and turn him into a Finn, essentially. And in terms of evolutionary biology, this is a blink of an eye. And so genetically, all of the scientific community in population genetics, and genetics in general, has basically said in the last 30 years, there's no such thing as race. We can't define it. We can't tell you what it is. Scientifically, it doesn't exist. And curiously, that seems to be not part of this dialogue at all. And I just, I'm astonished by it, actually. You know, I guess I wonder why not. And
I'm very glad that you said that. It's a truism, practically, in a kind of scholarly community. It's very fashionable to say, you know, race does not exist, it's a construction, which is true. It's a series of political and social and emotional and whatever constructions. It's very hard. I mean, a blink of an eye in evolutionary science, we're dead. It's very hard for people to get intellectually, let alone emotionally, let alone visually, their minds around, and we see the social consequences of this construction, set of constructions called race, races all the time. So I don't really know how we get that beyond, you know, the academy, beyond science writing, into the dialogue. Also, the repercussions are kind of explosive. What if we meaning Americans, had been able to talk about Obama as both a black man and a mixed race man? You know, that would have set complexities and contradictions in motion that, you know, would have been hair-raising. So we've got a lot to do that way, including challenging ourselves, but finding the language and the outlets and the frames, the story frames for this. How do you move it out of science, or academic deconstructionist discourse?
I think Skip Gates has a TV show trying to execute on your agenda. He asks celebrities mostly to donate their
Ben Affleck.
Yeah. We're laughing because, there's a reason they call it psychologic as opposed to logic. I mean, Ben Affleck was on the show, and the evidence is pretty clear that he's biologically related to a slave owner. But, you know, cognitively, he doesn't identify that way. So I think the idea is that we've got lots of exits that we can construct easily from this path of having this problematic around race. But the interesting question is, well, why don't we take those exits? I mean, we can prove what you just said, and Skip Gates has a TV show. It's not well rated. People don't watch it. So, you know, there's something going on, and we don't have enough time to talk about what that something going on is. But yeah, the possibilities for exiting from this way of living is they're all around us. It's just curious why we don't take up the opportunity to do it. Well, no. I wouldn't go there if I were. This is your turn. Is she right? Brazil solved the race problem?
I'm not going to go there on that. I will say that also looking at it, there are other factors that come into it, though, when I look at communities. I mean, I'm looking at issues of culture, issues of language, issues of class. And that kind of, you know, we want to talk about something under the rubric of race, if you will, or Latinos, if you will. What we're also talking about are issues that have to do with class, working class, or people who aren't working, communities that have been disinvested, where, like in the 1970s when the city went broke and they couldn't pick up garbage in the South Bronx or in East New York, and so cars would be left out. And those are communities that mostly were communities of color. And so, you know, is race a construct? Yes. But that reality is, you look around, it's like everybody kind of looks like me, kind of talks like me, and has certain cultural traits that we share. And I think that's really what I look at when I write these stories, when I'm looking at people. I mean, the language marker, for example. I use Spanish every day in New York City, probably more than I did when I lived in Miami. I mean, the thing is, if your ear is tuned to it, you can hear the different accents and realize that's a Dominican. That's a Mexican, that's a Colombian. You can hear it if you were raised with it. And so you're attuned to the differences. There are differences out there apart from the racial, you know, and the scientific approach to race. There are all these differences that bind these communities together and also present you with an opportunity as a reporter to look at what are the issues facing them. And I think that's, for me, that's really it. I mean, I won't want to look at race, if you will, apart from class. I think the kind of stories that I do look at the intersection of race and class and economic opportunity or the lack thereof, or being taken seriously as a political force or not. Those are all the things that I think are, for me, of interest.
Can we add gender?
Yeah.
It gets even more complicated.
Well, actually, Louise usurped my question because I was going to talk about the fact that science is not doing enough to talk about us being the human race. It's really culture, as Mr. Gonzalez just said. There are differences. But if each of us, in our own situations, for example, if Colombians were not looking at darker-skinned Colombians as being less than. So what I want to just continue with what Louise was saying is we need to start to understand that this is a European construct and we are all following it. We're following it with our Twitter Black group. We're following it with all kinds of groups. We are not saying to each other, we are all the human race. Now you look at Europeans, you find some with red hair, some with blue eyes, some with, you know, and we don't think of them as being a different race. You look at Black people and the way they look at themselves, they think of themselves as being ethnically different. We need more stories on that kind of thing. We need to find a way to look at the world as the human race rather than something that has been constructed to take away from those who are less powerful and less, I guess you could say, not the conqueror. Anyway, hi, everybody.
Thank you.
I think the Europeans did have a couple of issues with race in the past 100 years. But that said, your point's well taken.
Yes.
Hi, I'm Elizabeth Yuen. I'm a graduate of 98. Just yesterday, the Washington Post had an article on New York Times managers receiving a warning about diversity. And it also cited an American Society of News Editors 2015 survey showing abysmal minority newsroom representation. Often missing from the overall conversation and reporting on race, and also this panel, I must say, are Asians. And generally, the reporting and conversation is generally generally a black white paradigm. Even when reporting on immigration, it tends to be Latinos. How should newsrooms address this deficit? Is it in hiring more minorities in order to get more representation in the reporting? I wanted to ask how you would address it. And also, just to throw it out there, there is the Asian American Journalist Association Convention in Las Vegas on August 10th through 13th. I encourage everybody to go. Thank you.
Thank you. Who would like to take it?
Well, I'll go first. The one view is that if you could set up a subway style turnstile to the borders of the country, not a wall, a turnstile, it's very different, and select who gets to come in this country, and then you could do an experiment based on level of income, level of education, gender, use your imagination. What would you get if you started those kinds of quote unquote immigration policies? Well, for Asian Americans, at least since the end of the 19th century, American immigration policy, while it may have been racist and exclusionary and flawed in many ways, produced a middle class community upon arrival. I mean, how many times do you can we do a story about the talented Korean doctor who finally gets, you know, a visa into the country, who has to settle, quote unquote, for a job much beneath his level of training? Well, that's the magic in this society. He's got, he or she now has social capital, literal capital for success in America, which, and the contrary story is, if you belong to a group, Latin Americans, I mean, Latinos or African Americans, where your group can't be, quote unquote, stopped. African Americans are in this country. We can move anywhere we want to, but our place of origin is rural southern poverty. And until that's no longer a point of significance, we routinely repopulate ourselves as a group with difficulties. And the issue with Latin American immigration is it's a group that, in a way, can't be stopped. And the group is defined by low income, less well educated, et cetera, quote unquote, a group with problems. That's, I think, why you can see a serious difference, an important difference in how we talk about race in this country. If we did the experiment the other way, and the Asian community was now unquote unquote regulated, there you are. You're on this panel. We're talking about your problems.
I do think, I haven't been at the Times or Newsweek in a long time, but you know, obviously, if you are hiring from within a group which gets very few stories, if you hire intelligent reporters, they are going to be looking for stories that people aren't thinking about. Also, how do you follow up in a larger way on stories that exist? The Times did some cover, a little bit of one story, I think, on the conflict between the between blacks and Asians over the conviction of, was it Peter Liang, the policeman, because it was one of the only convictions of a policeman who'd been charged with shooting an unarmed black person, and you know, why the Asian conviction when there were almost no white convictions, and you know, what was this setting up in terms of even, you know, who suffers discrimination more, who's oppressed between black communities and Asians? I thought that was a fascinating story, and I didn't, with many implications about how minority groups connect. And also, you know, how many Asians, South or East Asian, are in the police force? I knew nothing about this. The story, as far as I know, was dropped. I also saw within, I think, 24 hours, maybe the same day, a piece on the city of Philadelphia finally issuing an apology to a long-dead Jackie Robinson for many examples of racist slurs hurled by their team, I guess. Mm-hmm. Many. Now, were these recorded? Were they filmed? Does anyone know? Okay, I think they weren't, or it wouldn't, among up for other reasons, have taken so long. Within a day, there was a story about an Asian woman who had been meticulously screening films of hard fouls and fouls that possibly were flagrant fouls against Jeremy Lin. And she edited these, she put them online, and it went viral. It raised a question of referees' discrimination against Lin because he's Asian. And I thought, what's going to happen with this story? How is it going to lead to interesting stories about the changing racial and ethnic dynamics and the relation, including referee and player, but also Asian players, Serbian and Croatian players, African American players? These are the kinds of ways also that one expands the coverage by looking at these always evolving relationships between minority groups, as well as their histories and what that generates in terms of what each community needs and feels has been neglected in terms of journalistic coverage.
Thank you. Can we move on?
Hi, I'm Maynard Eaton, class of 72. When I first left here, first part of my career, I covered TV news, was a reporter, covering racial issues and covering civil rights groups. Of the last decade living in Atlanta, I write for a civil rights organization. We do a civil rights magazine. My question is, has the coverage of civil rights groups and their activities fallen out of favor, or have civil rights groups fallen out of favor?
The official formal groups like NAACP.
SCLC, I'm right for SCLC, SCLC, NAACP.
The establishment groups.
Yes.
I think that's a result of, I think there is some conflict between the new civil rights groups, I guess Black Lives Matters, and what are the more traditional civil rights groups and just their makeup. And I think that the Black Lives Matters, just the genesis of it was very different than the traditional civil rights groups. It's not focused around the church. It's not focused around heterosexual men. It's not hierarchical in the same way. So I think that might have something to do with it, where that these two groups, NAACP, and then what's happening with Black Lives Matter, I don't think there's the cooperation, because they come from very different places, and I think that might have something to do with what you're talking about.
Yeah. I also they don't really talk to each other all that much either. I mean, it's like it's a totally different forum, and you do have it, especially because you're dealing with millennials and younger people in Black Lives Matter, that the social media is, it's Twitter, it's a different forum. They're not really connecting in that way, and they need to do more. We only have 5 minutes, so.
Okay, thank you all. I'm Kiara Sotile, class of 2011. My question is, I feel like this conversation, I'm thinking about this word paradigm, I feel like this conversation did what a lot of our stories do, which is go to a black-white paradigm and talk about narratives, like character-driven stories. And what I want to know, especially thinking about like Native populations, Indigenous populations, which we really didn't talk about, how are you in your work elevating the conversation beyond that conversation that we're already having, that we've been having for way too long, and really elevated into something that talks about institutionalized racism, for example, that really talks about race in a way that gets beyond like the one character in one neighborhood.
How else are you going to write a story, though, if you're not doing about one person or one situation? I mean, ultimately, my job and what I try to do is tell great stories. I want to tell stories that move people. And the best way to do that is you tell a clear narrative about what this person's... And you don't need to write about the issues to write about issues. And you just write the stories and let the stories speak for themselves. And that's at least the way I view my work. And I do that through just telling one person's story.
Well, I take this as a challenge, so I don't want to be defensive, and say, well, I've done this and that. I think for reviewers, for example, where you're focusing on small material, it's what you pick. It's, are you writing about a range of movies, TV shows, books that in fact cover the range of oppressed groups that you were talking about. That was certainly something in my years as a book reviewer that I tried very hard to do. Otherwise, I would say the kind of material you're talking about, the really ideas and analytic-driven pieces are going to come up in, essays, editorials, and whether, in social media or not, and in books. And hopefully, we all, certainly hopefully I do, attempt to make to do that. In that kind of work.
And I we're going to have to leave it at that. We've run out of time, but I want to thank our panelists, and clearly there is more to discuss and to open up the group, and we will continue to do that. So thank you so much. Appreciate that.
I want to remind everyone that there has been a change in the schedule. We're not going over to Low Library. We're going to do the Alumni Awards in this.